I'm doing my PhD in US in statistics. It's my last year. So yeah, so I'm teaching.
Okay. So he's a pro with R, and he deals with R day and day out. And he's gonna be conducting the second session on the plotting.
Basically data cleaning and a little bit of modeling. Yeah.
Modeling and the data visualization as described by Ronald this morning.
Yeah.
So I would allow Dasha to take the stage,
okay.
And please feel free to ask questions in anything.
Okay.
Also, the session is very important for your final projects. Basically, this afternoon session, Dasha works through a project which the process is very similar. Maybe exactly the same as what you will do in your final project.
So basically, it's like walking through how you should think and how you can process your data in a use case scenario. Hopefully, you will learn something good. Enjoy!
Okay. So we're going to start. Before we start, what I'm going to talk about is a process. I mean, it's a sequence. We'll do data analysis. Okay. There are all different kind of data. I mean, if you are do finance related jobs, you encounter time series data. If you do like business customer related jobs, I mean you have a relation based data, okay, like those in the SQL, and then you have join tables. So when you are faced with this kind of data, I mean how to do that? I mean how to do that? Several steps. Okay, the first step is of course you have to load your data. I mean you have the data, you load the data into the computer, okay, before you can analyze it. So after you load the data into your computer, I mean from MySQL, from a database, or from a CSV file, or from a TXT file, or from so-called the no SQL database, and then whatever fancy thing. I mean, eventually, it will be loaded into a processor, into a program. And then after you load the data into the program, the second step is you have to look at your data. Okay, you look at your data. I mean, there are several different ways. Okay, you can describe your data. I mean, make a summary, and then you can look how many variables related, and then you see which variable, what's the variance, what's the mean, and then what's the basic characteristic of that data. I mean, it can sometimes be a image. Okay, for me, I'm recently analyzing the brain image, MRI, so it can be a data volume. I mean, it can be of all sorts of data. I mean, after that, you have a first understanding of your data. You have to do data cleaning, okay, before you analyze it. You do data cleaning because in your data set there might be some problems, okay, due to a recalling problem or a run logic. Or missing value, this kind of thing. Okay, you have to clean your data set before you analyze it. After you have done your data cleaning, you have a basic understanding of your data set. Then you propose a model. Okay, whatever model, it can be for time series data. You can propose some smoothing models from some regression models or tree models and whatever, like most fancy model recently is the neural network, deep learning, this kind of thing. Okay, you propose models. After you propose your model, and then you feed your data to the model. Okay, you feed your data to the model. So in machine learning, it's called train your model. Okay, in statistics, it's called a fitting a model. Okay, after all, they are telling the same thing. Okay, so essentially the logic behind it, that is you propose a mathematical structure, and then you fit your data into that structure so that you can reduce a certain kind of error. Okay, so for example, you do a linear regression, So you just now you learned that you got linear regression, you got a line, a lot of dots around that line, and then somehow you minimize the error of the distance of all those dots to the straight line that you are going to fit. Okay, and then after you fit your model, you have to do model diagnosis. Okay. Sometimes you propose a model, a model have model assumptions. Okay. Sometimes if you do your model diagnosis, the model, eventually you look at all those model diagnoses, certain assumption not satisfied, then model should not be used. Okay. You may consider change your model. Okay. So the difference between a newbie, between a newcomer and university professor, it's a professor know more models. Okay, they have more tools in their toolbox. If you first day come in and do this thing, and then perhaps you have one or two linear regression, you know this, and then some other very basic models, you have less tools. This essential difference, but the process is almost the same. Okay, after you see that your data fit the model, and then model diagnosis and everything okay. Okay, and then you can proceed to do a prediction. Okay, so normally, okay, because we are learning R, R is very powerful. Okay, inside it got a lot of different packages. Okay, so you can usually if you have you choose the R package, you can automatically use that package. The function in that package do the prediction already. Okay, no need to write the prediction yourself. So then you achieve your purpose. Why you do machine learning, why you do statistical learning, whatever kind of computer-based data analysis, for most of you, the eventual objective is to predict something, right? From the data set, you can do some filtering telling, right? Yeah. For example, in finance, it's called the finance. There is something called the technical analysis. That's also machine learning. Okay. So in for example the image processing, it's also predict something, right? You learn some human face, and then you can give you another face. You can recognize this if it's smiling or it's crying or this kind of thing. Okay, it's detection. So now we're going to use a very small example, very small data set to demonstrate this process. Okay, we are going to run through the whole process so you have an idea of what's happening. So first step is load your data. Okay, so just now I think you perhaps already learned this command, right? Okay, so this is first step you have to set the working directory. So the WD is stand for work directory. Okay, working directory. So you have to set your work directory. How to set your work directory? So basically you type in global option appearance font size. Better?
Yeah.
Oh, I'll get it bigger, even bigger. Let's say 24. Okay. So set WD, set working directory. Okay, so my work directory, how to do that? If you are running under Windows, the very very simple method to achieve this. Okay, usually for you, you'll save your files into a certain folder, right? For me, I serve the file, going to load this data into the R. How to do that? You go there, and then you on this, okay? You click here, you have all the working directory. Okay, you can copy. Okay, otherwise a universal method is to do this. You go to property and then you have everything working directory here. Okay, so you copy So control plan, control C, you close it, and then you put here. You have to code into a quotation mark. Okay, but inside this, you have to change the slash into double slash. Okay, otherwise you'll return error. Okay.
Huh?
Oh, you don't have a file. There's no problem. I'll upload that. Sorry. Sorry. That's my mistake. I mean, okay. Let me upload it. Okay, 1 minute. So yeah, it's there. It's in your session 3 R part 2 folder. Yeah, you find it? Okay, so you do that, you set work directory, and then you load your file you set work directory, okay, to the folder where you save your file. And then you do this. I'll put a code into another file called code and notes. Okay, I'll copy and paste that code there, so you no need to type. I mean, you can just copy paste it. That'll be easier for you. So I explain it. So the file is analysis.txt. Okay, it can be a CSV. Okay. It's just read.csv, and then you put inside. But here we have lgread.table. Okay, analysis. This is the file name in the Google Drive.
Huh? I don't think there's a file.
You can.
It was there. Then.
Yeah. Huh? It was there and disappeared? Where? Where is that? You find the file?
Yes, already, but the set of the domain that you're using not included. You want us to test ourselves?
I already copy this code onto the Google Doc.
Yes, but without the first row.
Which one? This one? Yeah. Set WD. You have to use your own working directory. You have the file or not? Okay. Upload files. I'll upload it once again. Thank you. Is there? Okay. You copy the file instead of you cut the file. If someone cut the file out of the folder, I mean the file will disappear. Okay. You copy you paste it on your computer. I mean you don't cut it. If you cut it, it will disappear. You have it? Yeah, normally you should see something like this. Inside your folder, you should have one file called this analysis.txt, another file called code and notes. And then this one, you can open it. I'll paste the code onto this file so that you no need to type every time. Yeah, it'll be simpler for you. Okay. Have it? Okay. You go to your Google Drive. You'll find a folder. In the folder, you have two files. One is called analysis.txt, another is called code and notes. Okay? You download that analysis.txt into your computer. You put into a certain folder. Okay? And then you find that particular file. You do what I did on the RStudio. Okay? You set your working directory to Or you can first set the working directory to the folder where you want to do everything concerned. Okay? Yes? I had to go to this is an old one.
Yes, we have to open these, but just download it.
You have to have a part two, right?
Just right click it.
You have a login. No, you have a login. Yeah, I know. You have a Google account, right? You have Google Drive, right? Otherwise, you have to follow up. You have to ask someone to write an email for you and then write the. Yeah, ask your. Yeah. You said that, yeah? You said you No, you, okay, you know your directory, right? You know the directory. And then you set WD and then you put your food directory in here. You set WD. Yeah, you use the command. You set okay, you go to your file, go to the analysis file.
Yeah,
just how you should in the directory.
Yeah,
I can
okay.
Just move the okay, you find the property. The quality of the file. Okay, you have the
Second round.
Session 3, round 2, session 3, RD.
Session 3, part 2.
So, if you're in the Google Drive, you should search for this new folder called Session 3R Part 2. The three things that's required, the three documents that's required, all under that folder. Can you search for that folder right now in the Google Drive? You cannot go into the Google Drive. Let me check.
All Okay, otherwise I offer you another solution.
Can you upload it into session one?
You write me an email, I reply your email with a
part. Just download all this into session one as well.
Okay.
Because you guys all have access to session one, right?
Okay, okay, I'll get it to session one.
We'll drop the three texts about the texts required into session one. Please search for it there.
Okay, I'll get it to session one. Sure. Yeah, 或者你们帮我发一下也行。
我也知道这个不能这样，在这儿，咱尽量往前走。OK，没事，可以快的，后边可以快的，这个。哪三个？Analysis。OK，Analysis。是，说话时间是啊，我再
create 一个，是不是他刚才是不是也在这儿有一个那个？算了，我 create 一个，我等。可以啊，可以啊。
Notes. Okay, 就可以了。哪一个？就主要
analysis.
Okay, so everyone, please go to session 3R part 1. Download only one text, which is called analysis.txt. Can you all do that for me?
Yeah, just that one is good already.
Is it okay?
Sorry, for mine, there are two analysis.
Either one. Someone must have already put some. Okay, you only copy that file. Don't delete it, and you don't put something new inside.
Yeah, just download that folder into your computer.
Yeah, copy paste.
The
It's a 42 KB one, right? So the content of the analysis, you should see what
42.
The oxygen level.
42 KB.
It's a 42 KB file. Just download that one first, okay? Download analysis.txt, which is a 42 KB text. Has everyone okay? If you have any problems, just raise up your hand. If there's no problem, we'll continue with the lesson. Is that okay?
Are we on the same page?
Everybody is able to load into their own directories right now. Can I have a reply, please?
Yes.
Perfect.
Okay.
Then we will move on. Actually, no worry. I mean, after all, it's the first step. So I'll write everything on this part two or part one, part two. Okay, if you are on this folder, it's part two, but I'll write notes after all on part one. So just for everyone's can understand sake. Okay. So first step is you set your work directory, okay? So how to set your work directory, you go to the folder. I mean, for example, you save your file into a certain folder, you go to your file, you highlight it, you go to property, and then you find your link, okay? So all the full directory, that won't, you won't miss it. You go to full directory, and then you copy it, and then you put the directory into a double quote, okay? And then you set all the slash into double slash. Okay, and then you set work directory, and then you can load your file with this command. Okay, this command basically does several things. First of all, is you put your file name, okay, with extension txt. It can be other file type. It can be a CSV. Just now someone gave me a Excel file. Okay, actually Excel file can be read as well, but it's more complicated. So header, you got a header or not. Under our situation, we have no header, means the first line of that analysis. Okay, let's open our analysis file. So this is the content of this particular file. Okay, so we have a lot of data inside. We have a lot of XXX, XXX, and then we have a lot of numbers, some categorical variable. Okay, so the file like this. What do we mean by header? Header means the first line. Okay, if you have you do have a header, the first line will contain a lot of names. Okay, like this is what's the name of this particular feature. For example, this first one should be season. Okay, so you have no header, but you have to append header to your file. I mean to your, this is called a data frame. Okay, the previous lecture, normally your coach already talked about that. It's called data frame. Data frame, you basically by doing this you create a data frame. Data frame is a basic data object in our environment. Okay, so you do whatever manipulation, calculation on data frame. So you can consider it as a big matrix. And in this case, it's a two-dimension matrix. Each row is one recording. Okay, each column represents one feature. Okay, of that particular recording. It's like a spreadsheet. In spreadsheet, each row is a record. And then each column contains the one characteristic of that particular recording. Okay, so here we do first is the file name, then is a header. We don't have header, so we choose that equal to F. So false. Decimal places, sometimes decimal places is represented by a comma, but here we specify it as a dot. Okay, so we know what's the decimal places. So column names is basically column name feature of the data. So you have season, you have size, you have speed, you have max pH value, you have a lot of other chemical values. I mean chemical names. And then this is algae. And then NA string equals to this. Okay, this basically tells the computer what is NA string. NA string. String is a series of characters in the computer. So in this just now we saw that in the file we have sometimes a lot of this thing, non recordings. Okay, this is a problem with the dataset itself. So in computer there is a standard name for such situation. It's called NA, non applicable. N/A. Okay, it can be other forms. Okay, under this case it's a lot of X, and in other cases it can be a lot of N's or a lot of other things. Okay, so you are telling the computer when you encounter a lot of X, it's NA, it's not applicable. So a computer will assign another value. You replace all the X with NA. Okay, so it will be easier for later manipulation of the data set. So you do this, you load your data into your computer. I mean, okay, you have 200 observations and 18 variables. Okay, so after you have done this, I will, okay, let's look at the data. I mean, so you look at, say, let's say we read 10 lines. 10 rows. Okay, so head, whenever you have a data set loaded into the computer, I mean in data frame into the computer, you can you want to have a visual understanding, I mean the direct understanding of the data set, you can type head, the name of your data frame is called LG. Okay, I'll write that code into that. Okay, the code is on the code and notes. So after you type this, okay, this number represents how many rows you want. It can be 1, it can be 10, it can be 200. Okay, by default is 10. If you don't write anything, you put that there. Okay, 6. So you can look at the data. Okay, so the data, okay, this data set, I'll do a little bit explanation about this data set. This data set is actually the measurement of 200 water samples, okay, from different rivers, okay. So inside you find you find a lot of chemicals value recalling, because in the water, in river you have those kind of algae, okay, and then you want to predict because you have a different kind of harmful toxic algae, A1, A2, A3, until A7. You have seven kind of toxic algae. Okay, you want to monitor those the quantity of those algae in the river. But if you do that each time you sample, you test everything, that'll be very troublesome. Okay, you want to automate that process. So how to do that? It'll be very difficult to do biochemical analysis, but it will be simpler to just put a monitor there and test those chemicals inside the water. So by reading those chemicals, you can see the probability of having a certain kind of algae will be high or low. Okay, so that you can take measures. So this is the scenario of this data set. So here, you look at data set. This is a quantity of seven different kind of harmful algae, okay. And then this one is when the season when the sample is taken, okay. At what season? For example, winter. Size of it's a river size. It's a small river. It's a medium sized river or the large sized river. Speed. Okay. The water speed is high, is low, or other speed, high or medium or low, okay. Max pH is a pH value, okay. It's an acid or it's alkaline, or MnO2 is other chemicals. All those chemicals, these chemicals, you can just put a direct detector there and they can detect the value automatically. So you don't have to go there personally, take this water sample, do the analysis, wait for 1 week or 1 month to get a result. Okay, this one can actually produce a procedure, produce a model so that you can predict the value of harmful algae automatically. Okay. So this is the background of this data set. Okay, we have this data set, we load it into a computer, and we are ready to proceed to the next step. So next step, if you recall that we're going to look at our data, have a little understanding, of our data set, right? So how to do that? A very simple step is you summary, okay? So you just type that summary and then the R will automatically give you a lot of result about each variable, okay? So for example, you have a season, okay, summary is so you have autumn, you have 40, spring, you have 53, summer 45, winter 62, so on and so forth. And then minimum value, maximum value for, mean, median, first quarter, third quartile, and then this for different variables, okay? So minimum, maximum, you all know. Median is a middle, is a middle number, okay, by index. Mean is the mean, the average. First quantile is the first 25%, where that value is, so third quantile. Okay, you have a direct understanding. From this you can already see if the data is skewed or not, okay? But it's not that clear, so you can make some plots. Okay, just now I recall that you learn that how to do a histogram, so LGAE and dollar sign, okay, you can make histogram, okay, so you can have a histogram, you can plot a histogram, so you apply what you learned just now in the previous session. So so this is the name of a data frame. Dollar sign is the selector, okay. And then after the dollar sign, you can choose whichever value you want to plot. Okay? And our situation is MXPH. You can plot other things as well. Okay? So histogram if you look at the left side of your histogram, it's called a frequency. Okay? If you don't want a frequency, you can set it to probability. Okay, by adding probability equals to true. So on the left hand side will display you the density. Okay? What's the probability? That all depends on you. I mean, which value you want. You can also add some lines. Okay. Add the density line. Okay. Now you just made a plot. I mean, you draw the density curve around that around your histogram. Okay, you just add the density there. Okay, this NA dot remove is remove all the NA values, because NA value cannot be calculated. A lot of X or NAs cannot be calculated. So when you do the density basically you do a spline fitting. Okay, spline fitting inside the polynomial, you do a spline fitting at the back. So when you do that, you are actually performing some calculations. You have to remove those NAs, not applicable, no values. So NA dot RM equals to true. And then density perform on which value? I mean, the LG dollar sign MXPH. Okay, you can perform other variables as well. Okay, we have a lot of them, a lot of variables. You can try PO4, CHLA, and okay. So we've continue. Okay, you can further plot other things. Let's try this. Rock, this function actually plots something very interesting. Okay. It actually plots the dots, I mean the data points on at the bottom. Okay, so you can actually see each data point where they locate. Okay. You all know what's a histogram, right? Histogram. Histogram, you can think histogram as a bins, as a series of bins. Okay, for example, you have a bunch of data range from MXPH. Let's see MXPH. Okay, you have a bunch of data. Okay, range from minimum 5.6. Okay, somewhere here, to maximum 9.7. Somewhere here. Okay, this is the maximum value, this is the minimum value. Okay, and then you have median, mean. Okay, you have a bunch of values. And then histogram, what is histogram? Histogram, basically you put the, you chop your axis into different sections. Okay, I evenly chop them into sections. Each section considered as a bin. I mean, as a dustbin, I mean, they're like a bin. You put the, You each time you take a number, you put a number into that bin. I mean, you call into the value where it falls. So you put all the numbers into their respective bins. You have something like this, a histogram. This is a histogram from layman term. So this is a histogram like this. If your bin is smaller enough, very small. I mean, it's infinitesimal small, infinite small. You will have a curve like this. Okay, you have an infinite number of values, and then you put your value into infinite small bins. Okay, you will have a curve like this. Okay, so the curve is like this. in mathematics, it's a limit. It's called a limit goes to infinity. Okay, let's continue. Which one? Probability equals t means okay, t is true, f is false. Okay, it means if it is false, here is the frequency. Okay, let's go back. Okay, if we don't put a t, we'll have a plot like this. You look at here, you 70, 60 means under in this bin there are 70 of there are 70 numbers in this bin. Okay. There are around 60 numbers in this bin, okay? So this is, okay, there are around 30 in this bin, okay? If you put probability equals to true, okay, now it'll be from 0 to 0.7. So I'll say the probability of your data point fall into this bin is 0.7. Okay, so this is so-called probability equals to true. Okay. Are you okay on this histogram? Just now, actually, you plot histogram. I mean, histogram is nothing but a lot of bins. I mean, you put the data into the bins, and then you get a high low there. Okay. So we continue. We plot other plots. So we can plot box plots. Okay. LG here we OPO4 okay, this is a box plot of another variable OPO4. It's also phosphate. Okay, so it's the chemical formula is a PO4. P stands for phosphate or oxygen oxide. So also phosphate. So the box plot. This is a box plot. Just now you have you have a summary. You have OPO4. Okay, summary here. This part. This part is they are just numbers. Okay, very not easy to understand. So you want to make a plot, I mean have a visual understanding of the data, so you make plot. So this is the box plot of that particular variable. Okay. Same way you can also display all the data here, I mean as a site. Okay, site equals to 1 means so you plot this thing as a bottom. On the x-axis, side equals to 2 means you plot it on the y-axis. Jitter means okay. If two points fall on the same place, they will give a small arrow to make them separate apart. Okay, so it just means the little thing. Yeah, you have it. It's good to have. So otherwise, okay, you can also continue. You can plot this. Okay. So you can add a line on this plot. Okay, this is the mean of this particular variable. Na also equals to Na also will remove those Na's. Okay, Na dot remove equals to true. Okay, no need to type. I'll put the code onto that code. So you just copy paste. No need to type. Be a complicated, yeah. So you just listen. I mean, just listen. I'll explain to you. You no need to type. Yeah, you can copy paste. So you have this. What's a good point of box plot? I mean, good points of box plot. You can easily see that if the data is skewed or not. Okay, and you can easily detect the outliers. Okay. So this is a median. This is a mean. Okay. This is your first quantile. This is the first quantile. This is the third quantile. Okay, so all those points are extreme points. You can consider them outliers. Later, you want to remove them, or you want to have further examination on that. Okay. So now we just talk about the extreme values. So how to find extreme values? So we want to identify extreme values. Okay, outliers, so-called outliers. How to do that? So you can do this. Okay, here I plot another plot. So LG is this ammonia. Okay, NH4. Okay, so the ammonia in that water body. Here obviously you find this is outlier. Okay, but you don't know which point it is. You want to find which point it is so that you can remove it, right? Okay, so how to do that? There are two ways you can do that. One is a visual way. So let's put that. Okay, I put a plot there, so you can plot it. Before we do that, we can also plot some other lines there. So I'll give you some other code so you can play on that. For example, you can add the mean. Okay, this is the mean of all those values. You can add the standard deviation. Okay, standard deviation, mean plus one standard deviation is already this high, but that one is way much higher. So you want to identify that particular point, for example, there, okay, the extremes. So how to do that? So there is a function called identify, you can do that. So it's this one, okay? So let's run that. Okay, so now your cursor become a cross. So you put that here. You click. Okay. So already identified. Okay, you identify 3 points. Let's make another one of that one. Okay, you see that locator active, ESC to finish. So you click ESC, so finish. Okay. So all the index of the point you just clicked stored into that click variable. Okay. So these are the points you just clicked. So this is a 20, 35, 88, and that one didn't display me, and it's a 153. Okay? So this is very useful. This is very useful when you have a data set, you have extreme values, you can just remove them this way, visually remove them. Very easy to use. So then you can remove all those points, how to do that? Okay, I don't want to. Okay. All these points are your clicked value. Okay. This variable called the clicked is it hold the index of extreme values. Okay. So basically it's a vector. 20, 35, 44, and 153, a vector of 4 elements, okay? So LG, you can consider it as a 2x2 matrix, okay? You put the click here, it's basically telling you to take out all these rows of that index out, so you display all those extreme values here, okay? If you put a minus sign there, you can directly remove all those rows from your data set, okay? Which we don't want to do it now, for the moment, okay? Well, this is a visual way of for you to identify the extreme values. There is another way to identify the extreme values. I mean, more computational more, how to say, more technical. Can do it like this. Okay, this is also selector. So what you do is, LG, you put a square bracket, inside there is a comma, okay, comma, okay. The first value stands for the index on the rows, second value stands for index on the column, okay. So basically this one is a selector. You select all those rows that satisfy this condition. Okay. I put it here on the, you can find it on the note. So means that value is not NA, it's not a NA first. Okay, is okay, this is a is dot NA, so if it is NA, if it's NA is true, it's not NA is false. Okay? Is NA. Okay, if it is NA and then you negate it. And then means it's a number. And then that value bigger than 19,000. Okay, 19,000 around here means obviously you can detect this point. Okay? So by doing this, you also select 153. Recording 153. Ammonia 24,064. Okay, you also detect that particular outlier. Okay? Are we on the same page? Any questions? Questions? No? Okay, so far it should be very simple. So since inside we have a lot of NAs, okay, we want to deal with it. Okay, you have a lot of NAs, obviously want to you want to, how to say, do something about those problematic data points. So how to do that? There are several ways. Okay, first way, you simply remove them. Okay, that's when you have a very big data set, like you have 1,000 data, 2,000 data, you have like a quarter of a bunch of problematic data points, you can simply remove them, do your know-how. Okay. But that won't usually happen. I mean, sometimes you just have a very small data set. So you have to use other ways, okay? You can either fill your data set with the most frequent value, I mean, do some intelligent guess, okay? For example, somewhere you have those NAs, okay, or non-applicable, you can fill that particular hole with most frequent value of that column, okay. For example, you have in that particular ammonia, okay, a lot of values around like a lot of for example 6,400, and then you can fill that hole with 6,400, or you can fill with mean of that column or median of that column, okay. Or more advanced, you can also explore the correlation shape between different columns. Our situation, okay, later we're going to see that we are going to explore the relationship between all PO4, also phosphate and phosphate, and this PO4, these two values, they are all something related to phosphate, okay. You think that there might be correlation between these two columns, okay? So you can explore their linear relationship, for example, and then you construct a small model, and then you have one, they are correlated. You have one value, and then you can fill the other value if it is missing. Okay, this is what we do. Or more advanced, you can fill. You can use. You can explore the similarities between cases. This is the most advanced one. I mean, usually, in more proper data analysis, I mean, you use this one. It's you use cluster, I mean, you have, for example, 200 observations, okay? You have observation that have all the characteristic list there, and then you will find within these 200 observations which observation is most similar to that one, okay? And then you use the value of that similar recording to fill the holes in this particular recording where you have a hole. Understand? I repeat once more. So the most usually used method is okay. Just now we have actually four ways to deal with unknowns. First one is remove it, delete it, simple. Second one is you use some simple guess. Okay, simple guess means you can fill that particular hole with mean or median or mode of that particular feature across the whole data set, and then you put it there. Third way is you explore the correlation between different characteristics. Okay, for example, something all related to phosphate, or something all related to nitrate. Okay, you use this similarity. I mean the correlation. You construct a small model. For example, construct a feeder linear model between them two. You have x, and then you predict the y for. Or you have one value for x, another value you predict the y for that. So you can fill the holes. The third one. Is the most sophisticated one is you explore the similarities between the data points. Okay, you have a Mona Lisa, okay, but Mona Lisa without one arm, and then somehow you find another picture that looks like a Mona Lisa. I got an arm there, and then you draw that Mona Lisa draw out the arm with a reference of that full picture. So it's like that, okay? Explore the similarities between data points, okay? So we start to do that. The first method, simple, you just remove it. So I'll do that. So several ways, okay, you first find the incomplete cases, okay? Which is a very powerful function. I don't know if a previous session that your tutor taught you that. Which is a very powerful function. Which is something will tells you the index of the data in the data set which satisfies certain conditions. Okay, it tells you that the index of the data points which not complete. Okay, this phrase actually says that it's not complete. Complete dot cases means that particular recording got no NAs inside. Okay, remember what I said, you have 200 observations. Each observation is represented by a row. Okay, each row. You have 200 rows. Okay, so complete cases means that on that row, there is no NAs. All values properly listed. And here we want to find out the index of rows where you have NAs inside. Okay, it's not complete. So with this, you find a lot of rows already 12, 13, 15 of them. So yeah, almost 18 of them. A lot of, and then you can remove them. You know how to remove them, right? Yeah, you keep an index. So you have an ID. You all recorded in the ID, and then how to remove it? Very simple. LGAE. Your negative ID dot comma. You don't click enter, because if you click enter, your LG will become lesser. Become other things. So you have to load it again. So you have LG, and then if you want to remove all those NAs with all those problematic recordings, just do this. And then you remove it. Okay? So yeah, you can display it. You can also display it. Yeah,
Yeah, these are all your NAs. Yeah, this is a display of all those recordings. Yeah, NAs. Okay. So you can do what I did. You just negative ID. You can do this. Oh, there is a function, very nice. It's called LGAE, and then you have NA.omit. Okay? Same thing. You're actually doing the same thing. You omit all the NAs, all the recordings of NAs. You don't click enter. If you click enter, your LG will become a smaller set. Okay? If you click enter, you have to reload your data for later things. Or you can remove some particular values. So for example, you can also do this. For example, 62, 199. Okay, this is actually you can select a particular recording, remove them. Yeah, but in the previous session, I think your coach already talked about that. You remove certain observations. You create a vector, contain the index, and put a minus sign in front, and then you can remove all those the two rows from the data set. Okay? And give you a more advanced thing. Okay. So in this line actually tells you, okay, in this line what it does is this, it finds out the row where NAs inside that row is above 20%. Okay. So it means, for example, you have one row, you have 18 variables. Okay, 18 variables. So 20% of it is four variables, around four variables is NA. So if you're, it is actually find out the observations with like five NAs or six NAs, okay? More than four or more than three, okay? A lot of NAs. It is because there are two situations. Some values you simply have like you only have one NAs, one observation, you know, you have like 20 characteristics, you have one characteristic is not recorded. It's okay, I mean you just fix it. But if, for example, you have some recordings like you have 20 of the 20 of the characteristic, you have 10, half of the observations is not recorded. So this you cannot fix. Okay? So very bad recording, so we remove them. Okay, you can treat that with two different measures. You can remove them. So you do that by this. This is actually very powerful. This is a very powerful function. Okay, it applies to all the rows. One represent rows. LG is the name of the data frame. So it apply a function on all the rows of this data frame. So what a function? Function is defined as a Boolean function. A Boolean function is written as this: function x space. So sum of NAs divided by the number of the total number of the column. Okay, is bigger or equal to 20%. Okay, if it's bigger or equal to 20%, it return true. If it's not bigger than 20%, it return false. Okay. So you put everything inside which, and then you find out the index. So we do this. So let's see. Yeah, you have two values. Have a lot of NAs. Okay. For example, we. Let's look at the. So I take all these two observations. I mean, you got a lot of NAs there for 62, and you also got a lot of NAs there for 199. Okay, all these things are considered as a very bad. Okay, a lot of not unknown. So most probably going to remove it entirely. We don't use that because almost nothing recorded. Right? Almost nothing recorded, so remove them. For those only got one NAs, I mean, probably you still want to use that. Okay, you fill in NAs and I can still use a data point. Okay, so this is one way you remove it. Another way is to fill it with the most frequent value. Yeah, that would be more complicated. So what you do is this. Okay. You find a particular observation and then you fill it one by one. Okay. This is actually find the LD character MXPH row number 48, and then you fill this particular hole with mean of that particular column with all the NA removed. Okay. I didn't load the data again. I mean, you can do that, or you can mean can be replaced by a median. Yeah, for example, you can do other things like this. This is the median. I put a code on the. You want to undo that one here, right? Normally you can. Because every time, okay, if you do that, you destroy that that particular variable. You replace it with something else. So now you cannot retrace back. Yeah. You something like you override it. You override with something else. Right, that particular memory is right written by something else. I mean,
but can we duplicate the buffer and make a copy backup?
Yeah, of course you can. You can set a dummy variable. I mean, set a LG, for example. Here you can do this. What you do is normally you do okay. LGA.
Beast.
Yeah, you can keep the original record. Yeah, that is a very good point. Okay, that is a very good point because some operation inside your R is destructive. So you destroy some variable. I mean, you want to keep it. So you want to keep a record at the site. But it's okay. I mean, under our situation, we have the original data text file. I mean, you can just load it once more. We have the original one. It's not a problem, but what your friend said is absolutely very important. Okay, if you do a certain operation, you are not sure about it, and then you better keep a copy at the site. Okay, you do it, and then if something goes wrong, you can go back and do it again. Okay, that's very important. So just now what I said is you can fill either with a mean or with a median. Okay, I already write the code on the Google Drive. Okay, so you can fill that with the first line is filled with mean. Mean is you find a particular value and then you just put the value there. Second one is you basically fill the all the NAs of that particular column with a median. Okay, so all up to you which one you want to choose. Here, since the last session, you learn how to write functions. There is also the function you can Yeah, frequent fill. I mean, I also write a function that you can fill that you can use that function. Yeah. Yeah, this is a function that exactly does that. I mean, you put a data, I mean, for, you know, from none of the column is numeric, and then data is median, is true, and then else and factor means from top. Okay, so it's a function. I mean, and then it's a frequent field. Most it's a field basically those NAs with median. Okay. Yeah, for numeric variable, it's filled with a median. For factor, for categorical variable, it's filled with the most frequent one. Okay, this function actually does this. Yeah, you can load the function inside your R and then you can use it. Okay. You know how to load the function. Just now you learned how to write a function, but this one is a little bit more complicated. Yeah, it's you have a logic. So you have a data set which is a 2x2 matrix. Sequence is actually create a sequence from 1 to the number of column of the data. So here is 20. Okay, from 1 to 20. Okay, then for each column, if this column, the data in this column is numeric. Okay, is numeric. If this is true, okay, you will fill the NAs with median of that particular column. Okay, if this one is not numeric, I mean if else, okay, if not numeric, you will put this column of data as factor. You add the factor data. Okay, you store in the fact. Okay, and then this is the level of fact, which level is it's okay max. This table of fact actually gives you a table, the frequency. This is called a frequency table. Okay, it's a frequency table basically tells you for each category there are how many counts. Okay, then you find the maximum of it, and then you choose that factor, and then you put it on the NA part. Okay, so and then you return your data. So this is basically this function, what the function does automatically. Okay, I mean you're going to have this function, I mean, you can play at home. Any questions? I mean, should be fairly easy to understand. Okay, another one will be more complicated. So we fill the unknowns by exploring the correlationship. Okay, explore the correlationship between variables. How to do that? So we first have to find which one is correlated with which, right? So what we do is we find a covariance matrix. Okay, we look at the covariance matrix. But this one is not so obvious. There is another function where you can do this. This is a covariance matrix itself, and then we create a sparse one. Okay. This is a covariance matrix, very sparse. You find a stars there. Okay. So stars means that there is some significance there. So you find this one, and this OPO4 is correlated here. Right? So when you look at this, you can create covariance matrix, you know what it is, right? Okay. It's a little bit mathematical. You have how to describe that? Okay, wait on. I'll give you a Wikipedia. Okay, they got an equation like this, but you previously you learned this, right? Somewhere in your high school, covariance matrix. Okay, if you don't understand this, okay. Means, okay, if in this matrix, if you do this, okay, you put a lot of columns, a lot of data vectors inside this. Okay, use complete observations means all those observations with no NAs. Okay, you put a lot of vectors inside this function will return you a matrix. You find those values that is very big. Okay, very big, close to 1 or negative 1. Okay, it's if it is 1, it means perfectly positively autocorrelating. Okay. If it's a negative one, it's a negative autocorrelative. Positive autocorrelative means one variable. Okay, got two variables. They are perfectly autocorrelated. Means you have one variable increasing, the other variable will definitely increasing at the same time. Okay, they are so called autocorrelated. Negative autocorrelative means you have one variable increasing and the other variable decreasing. Okay, so this is so called negative autocorrelated. So if you have this matrix, you will find those values that very that have a very big absolute value. Okay, if the absolute value is very big, means these two variables are very highly autocorrelated. Okay, so OPO4. So for example here, we have this matrix. Okay, this is calculated automatically. So you have this matrix, you have a PO4 and OPO4, these two variables, and then you have this number 0.9. Okay, very close to 1. So they are highly positively autocorrelated. Okay, if it is negative 0.9 is a negative autocorrelated, but it's 0.9, it's very big. You know, 1 is perfect. Okay. Why is it 1? Because it's with itself. So this is OPO4, this is OPO4, so here is 1. You are definitely autocorrelated with yourself, right? So with other variables, this one is very big. Okay? So we want to explore the correlation. We want to explore this. We can use the value of this one to predict the value of this one. Okay, so this is so-called explore the correlationship between different variables. How to do that? So we want to do that. We do it like this. We still have 200 observations. We first remove those problematic points. Okay, so this one I just explained. I put a negative sign and I remove them. They are not useful because we got so many NAs, I remove them. So you have 198 observations, okay? And then we start to produce our regression. Linear model, okay? Yes? You mean the dots? Yeah. The dots is okay. Because this is not so well displayed. You have some all these points. Some this one should be a star. This one should be a dot. Because display here is not so good.
So
So it's it represents some range. So you can go to the PO4. Okay, for example, it basically represents a range. Yeah. Because just now that plot. Okay, this matrix is very big. It's not so easy for you to find out that 0.9, but this one will give you a sparse version of that one. Okay. I put the code there. So you can do that yourself. Okay, it's already on, so you can plot yourself. So the COR is the correlation coefficient. Okay, range from -1 to +1. Okay, you want to find the values very close with absolute value close to 1. Okay, means they are highly correlated. This one will create you a sparse version of that one because they're so big and there's so many numbers, very difficult to find out those values. So you get a sparse version, it's fine, it starts there. Okay, so and then you find these two are correlated, I mean actually correlated. So you create a model. You create a model here. So the model is the PO4, and then this is your y, this is your x, and then data is this, and then this is linear model. You fit it and got coefficient this, and then this is the slope. This one you know, right? This one not a problem. Just now the previous session the coach taught that, right? Yeah, this is just a fit a thing, very simple linear model. So with this we can, okay, value 28, the PO4, okay, the PO4 is NA, okay? PO4 is related with the OPO4, and then we know that rho 28, PO4 is NA, okay? So how to do that? We find out it's rho 28, so what we do is this. Okay, so we use our intercept, we use that slope, we sub in the LG of OPO4 at row 28, we get the PO4 at row 28. By doing this, we fill the gap. Okay? Understand? Any questions? Any questions? All clear? Okay. Very nice. So the last method is to exploring similarities. Okay. Exploring similarities is this one is it's a little bit complicated. I'll give you a function first. Okay, you call the k nearest neighborhood. Okay, what is k nearest neighborhood? It's basically this. You look at this plot. We happen to have this plot. For example, we have a plot with a lot of points. We find the k nearest points near this one. Okay, so-called similarities. We find similarities. By similarity, we are calculating a Euclidean distance between each point. What is you do know what is Euclidean distance, right? Euclidean distance is okay, let's do this. Okay. You have, for example, under two-dimensional plane. This is x. This is y. This origin. You have a point. This point. This point. Okay. Euclidean distance is basically this. the straight line you connect these two, this is your Euclidean distance. How to calculate that? You have x, y. Okay, this distance is the square root of x squared plus y squared. Okay, very simple trigonometry. But under high dimensional cases, you have more variables, and in this case you have a z. Okay, this three dimensional, you just plot, plus a z there, z squared. Okay, and in our case, we have 18 observations, we are 18 dimensional. Okay, so you are expecting this inside this, you have 18 of them. Okay, so this is so-called Euclidean distance in high-dimensional space. Okay, it got a mathematical name. So you find the k nearest one near the, your center point. I mean, I'm not going to explain the equation, but later I'm going to copy paste it to it. So if you you'll be got very long, it's very long. So you can use it after all. So that's so it's called KNN imputation. So I am going to copy it and paste it. Okay. And what you do is this. You copy paste this equation and then you run it. And then it's loaded into your function. Okay, you find here you got a function called a KNN imputation. And that's good enough. K equals 10 means you find the 10 nearest point among all the points. Okay? So under, as what I explained just now, you want to find a, you have a point, and inside the point you got some problematic holes. So what you do is you find a K nearest point near this point, and then you average these 10 points. And then you put the average value for that particular feature into this hole. You get what I mean? I explain a little bit more. So it's like you have a point. So it's x1, blah 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 until x18, and then you have a lot of these points. You have like 10 of them. This is a point 1, this is a blah 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 until point 10. Okay? So you have a certain point here, you got a hole here. Okay? For one feature, you got a hole here. So you find the 10 nearest point near this point, they above others. Okay, you find out that they're similar point. And then you average all the other points. You find that the value on this particular dimension, and then you average all that numbers, and then you fill in it. It basically that function does this. Okay. Yeah, if you want to explore a little bit more, you read this function and then you understand it. Okay. So, this is the fourth method, mean give you a logic. So far we have we know how to clean our data set. Okay? So we proceed to do analysis. Okay, we want to propose a model for our data. Okay? Now it's we enter into a real analysis part. So the first model is I'm going to talk about is a multiple linear regression. Okay, multiple linear regression. So we, since we already learned, I'm going to use that. A central value, okay. I have another auxiliary function. I copy it onto your file, and then you can copy it there and then run it. Okay. our data is clean, and then what I'm going to do is do multiple linear regression. So how to do that? Simple linear regression is just the x and y. So multiple linear regression is actually by the same logic, but you got more dimensions. So what we do is this. So we predict one algae. We have 7 of them. We predict one of them. Okay. Linear model LM represent linear model. Okay. LM dot A1, and then you have LM function, and then you have A1 tilde dot. Okay. It's a dot. Here you got a dot there. And then data is from the data set first column until the 12th column. You use all the data. So this one, by doing this, you actually create the most general model for your data set. For most general multi-linear model. So let's see what we have. Okay, and then okay, let's I'll explain. Okay, what is okay. Okay. So basically what happened is this. You have a bunch of points, a lot of points here. You have a lot of points here. Okay. You want to create a model. You want to create a model that minimize the total the distance. Okay, this is the distance from okay, this distance got a name. It's called a residue. Okay, it's called a residue. The error you're going to minimize is called total sum of residues. Okay, total sum of residues. You square all the residues, because residues can be positive and can be negative. You take all the residues squared, and then you sum them up, and then you want to minimize that particular thing. And then this model, your linear regression actually does this. It minimize all the residues. All the errors. Okay, and then you create a line. Multiple linear regression means it's not just a line, it can be a plane. Instead of a line, we got in three dimensional space, you feed the model your y equals to alpha plus beta x1 plus gamma x2. You have a 2x, right? And in that case, you have a plane. So in three dimensional space, it's like this. Fitting to a multiple linear regression for three dimensional space, you are actually fitting a plane instead of a line. Okay, plane is also you got a lot of points on three dimensional space. You have a distance. You have a distance between that. You see, this is perpendicular to the plane, and then you are calculating this distance. Okay. Yeah, a lot of points. So you have a point projected to that plane. Okay. So that distance, minimize that distance. On even higher dimensional space, it's called a hyperplane. Okay, like 18 dimension is called a hyperplane. It's you cannot visualize it. It'll be more difficult. What is a linear model? Linear model means what is a linear model? A basic linear model example is this. you have a y equals to a number, I mean alpha, plus beta, plus as fx plus gamma gx. Linear model means here is linear. Inside this part is not necessarily linear. Okay, this can be x squared or sine x or cosine x or other thing. Okay, you just the coefficient. This is a number, and then this can multiply. We can add in together. So they are linear by this, not by the function x. But if you don't understand this, it's okay. So here we create this. So someone sent me a message. Chia Chuan Li. Okay. Okay, that just now that it's a little bit explanation of multilinear model. So we have done this. So after we have done this, we can do this ANOVA analysis of variance. Okay. This is actually helping you to understand how to choose a good model, because how to construct that model is also very important. Which value is more related to the result? Because you have a lot of variables, not every variable related to the end result, right? You want to find out that particular variable that related to your result. Okay, this actually does this. So this one, the p-value is not very good. Okay, so you want to remove it. P-value actually here is actually doing a test, a statistical test. Okay, this statistical test actually says that the parameter for this value can be zero. Anyway, okay, after you create this one, you do ANOVA analysis of variance. Okay, this is analysis of variance, and then you put your model inside. We'll give you a table like this. Like this, you find the largest the parameter with the largest p value. Okay, so you can reduce it. Okay, you can remove that value. How to do that? You can update it. So we go second step. Update your model is lma1 dot tilde dot. So this is your dot model. Dot model means the most general model. We don't specify the model structure. Here is the most general one. So your minus season means you remove the season variable. Okay, and then you can compare the difference. After you have done this, you compare the difference. Okay? This is a joint F-test. F-test, you got a p-value actually also very big, 0.7. When p-value is very big, it's not good. Means that the difference, the significance means they are not significantly different. Okay? Well, when this normally one, this one is be a smaller than 0.05, okay. But you don't want to do that step by step. The R is very good, so you can perform that automatically. So what you do is final LM, final linear model. You can use this step function. Step function will do that for you. Automatically, this actually calculate AIC. AIC is a CAIC information criteria. The theory is a little bit complicated, but I mean, it's automatic and it can give you a result. Okay, running several steps, give you a final model. This is your final model, your final LM. Okay, so what do you do? You can summary. Okay, so this gives you a summary of that model. So multiple R square is not so good, but I mean, it's already the final, means the linear model, it's the final one. Yeah, this is the structure of the model. It contains size, MX, pH, nitrogen, trioxide, ammonia, phosphate, also phosphate. Okay, this is your final model structure. It looks like this. Okay, it's automatic. It's automatic. Basically, your step is you got three steps. First step is first line is I put on the Google Drive file. First step is this one. Okay, your first line put this, and then you directly can go to the final step. Final step. I mean, step on the first one, you do multiple steps and automatically will reduce you the best multiple linear model. Okay, it'll give you a final step. In the middle, you can check with ANOVA or with a summary, you can check. I'll copy paste the model code on the file, so you can. Okay, but how to? After you have produced the model, you have to do the model diagnosis. There is something called model diagnosis. So how to do that? Actually, there are several plots. It's good to know. Okay, I'll give you a dummy model. I'll create a model. So this is a X, this is a Y based on X. Okay. Okay, this is a toy model. This is a toy model. It's not related to our data set, but it's a toy model for explanation purpose only. So actually, I create a 100 data point. I mean, random number range from 0 to 10. So I create a model, have an intercept 1 and have a slope 2. This is a create model, and then the R norm, because we have give you some white noise. A white noise 100 number range from 0 to 1. Okay, so we feed the linear model. We feed the linear model as what I did. Lm y tilde x. You return the formula intercept 0.679, and then x equals to 2.0 something. Yeah, the slope is pretty good. The slope is around 2. I mean, the real slope is 2. Okay. If you get let's say we get more, if a number is goes bigger, let's say 1,000 point. Yeah, so if you got more observations, you got more points, your estimation will become better, right? Your estimation become better. So here is 1.067, here is 1.987. Yeah, so you got the intercept, this real intercept is 1, real slope is 2. Okay, more points mean you can go to 1 median, I mean they're almost equal to 1, almost equal to 2. So model diagnosis is something like this. This is so-called model diagnosis. Give you a plot. Give you four plot. Okay. This command is basically tells you create a frame where you can put a 2x2 beam plot. Can put four plots. Okay. If you don't put that command, if you don't put this, yeah, the plot will pop out one by one. Okay. So it just does that. So I zoom out. We're doing multiple linear regression. I mean, usually you'll find these things for model diagnosis. Because this is our dummy model, I mean our toy model, I explain you this. So first one is called residue against fitted value. Okay? So if the model is linear, you will find that there is a straight line in the center, all the dots are evenly distributed to up and below. Okay? It's just like this. So this is one assumption. Okay, model is linear. Another assumption is normality. Residues your residues are normally distributed. Because we generated the model ourselves, so our model is normally distributed. I mean, so this is so called the QQ plot. Okay, QQ plot. Theoretical quantile is a quantile for normal distribution. And then standardized residues is the residues against the theoretical quantile. I mean, the feature you are looking for is you have a straight line. You have all those points follow on a straight line. I mean, if this satisfies, that model is good. Okay, means the normal hypothesis is satisfied. So this one is a scale location. Okay, this one is if the model is good, you will find a straight line. Okay, this one is actually testing for this is for the stability, the stationarity of the model. Okay, if you know what is white noise, okay, if this one is not good, what you have? You will have something like this. I'll explain. Okay, if the model, okay, sometimes the variance will become bigger and bigger. Okay, means you will have this, you will have those points here, and then those points are very, so you will have a point on like this, on this region. If you find on that plot like this, that model's criteria, I mean, hypothesis is not satisfied. Okay, so but this one is good, yeah, no problem. This one is called a standardized residue against the leverage. This one is more for looking for the outlier. Okay, outlier here we don't have outlier. I mean, normally you will have a dashed line on this plot somewhere here or somewhere here. If within the dashed line range, you find some dots there. That dashed line is called Cook distance. So you will find dots there. There are outliers. So you have to take a look at that. Okay, for more, okay, this is a standard procedure for model analysis. I'll give you a reference, I'll give you a web link, so you can, okay. On this page, you have a lot of explanations. So if you have a QQ, you have a, first one, okay, this one is better, this one is nonlinear model. Okay, you may change nonlinear model, something like nonlinear model. This one is normal QQ plot. This one is not, but it means normality criteria, I mean, hypothesis not satisfied. This one is what I described, it's going bigger and bigger. This one is normal, it's good. This one is not good. This one got some, if you find, okay, on our plot, there is no this dashed line because we don't have outliers. If you have outlier, you expect to find the Cook distance, and within that you have a point here. Okay, if you have a point here, it means you got outliers, and you have to deal with that. I give you this link. You can read that at home. it's more theoretical. I mean, it's more good to know. Okay, you can read at home. So this is multiple linear regression. We talk about this about within like 20 minutes. You know, in a university class, it's like they will teach like three class minimum. Yeah, three class minimum. Each class 2 hours. Yeah, about this this thing. So okay, so this is so-called multiple linear regression. Okay, but we want to do more than that. Okay. More than multiple linear regression. In multiple linear regression, the problem with it, it's a global model. Multiple linear regression is a global model. You use all the data, okay, at the same time, okay. But it might not be okay. The data might not be data feature might not be global, okay. For example, sometimes the data behavior are one part of it. Is different from the other part of it, right? It usually happens, and not really. All the model will follow a global feature, right? So, what we do is I'll introduce you another model. It's called tree model. Decision tree. Decision tree basically got two subcategories. One is called a classification tree. Okay, decision tree for classification. Another is called decision tree for regression. Okay, and basically they are following the same procedure. It's just what's the difference between classification and regression is that the classification, you have the outcome are discrete. We'll do classification, outcome is discrete. Outcome is discrete is the classification. Outcome continuous, it's a regression, okay? Basically, they are all like fitting a function. They are fitting a function. So let's look at it. To use the regression tree, we actually need R part. Okay? You know how to load the library, right? You have to load a library called rpart. Is it in your computer? If you cannot load the rpart, you can install packages. You can do this. Okay, you can download the rpart and then install it. Okay, you all got the package? It's loaded. Yeah, normally you automatically download the package. After you have installed the packages, you do library IRY and then R part. Yeah. Okay. And then you need another package. It's called a R part plot. You also need this one. So this one is helping you visualize the tree. Okay. So what is the tree decision tree? Decision tree is actually it's actually very simple. For example, you have a bunch of students, okay. You are HR, and then you want to choose the candidate. So you have 100 students, and then you can set a lot of criteria. For example, math result, work experience or not, no machine learning or not, handsome or not, beautiful or not, high or not, tall or not, right? By following this criteria, you can part your student, I mean, a bunch of people into different subgroups, a lot of subgroups. Okay, so you can choose a subgroup that satisfies all your criteria, and then that your candidate. Okay, this is the thing. It's like you have a lot of criteria for waters. So you can say you got more ammonia or not, you got ammonia bigger than a certain value or smaller than a certain value, and then you got two groups. And then you look at the phosphate bigger than a certain value, smaller than a certain value, you part two groups. And then you go down, and then you, for example, you look at hydrogen is bigger than a certain value, smaller than a certain value, you part two groups. You go further down, okay? And then you certain level, and then there is a criteria to gauge the error of those trees, okay? Because they are fitting something. So you have you build a decision tree for your data, and then we will have a new data point. You have a new data point. You can trace that tree, and you go to you have a data point with different features. You go through your data tree, and then you go down. You find a particular leaf that corresponds to your data point, and then you can use that point particular leaf to predict your result. Okay. Any questions? We all have RPath plot installed. Those who haven't installed it, all done. Okay. So we have a data set. Okay, so this is how to use it. So basically, your RPath, so RT, so it's called a regression tree. Okay, because we are not doing classification, we are doing regression. Our outcome are continuous variables. Okay, so continuous variables means it can be any number, I mean real number within a certain range in continuous. Discrete means it can be it's only a certain point, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, like 6 categories. Okay, so our A1 is continuous, called regression tree. So this is how you do that. Data is data LG from 1 to 12. Okay, so you run it, you have RT dot A1. Okay, this is your model. So let's plot it. Okay, so this is why it's so small. It again. Ah, okay. Yeah, I know. I'm doing that. Yeah. Okay. So this is a so-called tree model. So this is automatically building a tree like this. You have yes, no, right? You have PO4, bigger 44, yes or no. If a yes, you got test another variable, chloride, bigger than 9 or not. Okay, if yes or no, it is yes, and this is no. So also for phosphate, bigger 51, and NO4, NO2, bigger 10, so on and so forth. Okay, then you have a lot of, this is so-called a tree. Okay. Later, when you have a point, when you have a new point, when we want to make a prediction, and then you go to this tree, you just test for different variables, and then you look where your point falls. Okay, from that you can already see what's your A1. Okay. This actually tells you how much percentage of variance is explained by this tree. I mean, here we rise to 40%. It's much better. I mean, it's several percent better than our previous linear model. Our linear model is 0.3 something, 37% or 35%. Here it's 40%. It's bigger than that. Okay.
The second one, 7% is...
7% is, okay. This one is, so this is iteration. I mean, so you have ending... this is where you stop. Okay. So for example, we can build another tree. So CP equals 0.08. So means if this is smaller than 0.08, you'll stop. RT2. Let's see. See. Okay. Okay. This is a decrease in the variance. I mean, this goes in the mathematical structure. I mean, so you set a threshold. You set a threshold. You can set it smaller. So it means that you set a threshold smaller. The algorithm will stop slower, and then it will run more iterations, and then your tree will become more precise. But that also means that you have a risk of overfitting. Okay, if you have that error very very small, there is a risk that you have overfitting. Overfitting will means you have a big variance, a low bias.
So then the decision will depend on how big is the stretch for the car.
Yeah.
Can we realize this decision tree comparing to this one again? Finally, which one will you choose?
That one you got that one you have to test your prediction error. A very standard method is you do a prediction, okay, which we'll go that later. So you have a tree, okay, you can use that tree to make prediction by using test data. Okay, you make prediction, and then you will see that, for example, mean square error. Okay, you have a different trees, and then you can compare them. Okay, those tree with the smallest prediction error, and you choose that one. Okay, I mean, this is a silver bullet. This is usually the silver bullet for comparing all the models. Okay, further than that, okay, this is just one tree. This is just one tree. This is called decision tree. Above decision tree, there is something called random forest. Okay, from tree to forest means you have more trees. Okay, what's the difference? Random forest is called ensemble method. Okay, ensemble algorithm. So under this case, what you do is with your data, you build a lot of trees, okay? You build a lot of trees. How to build a lot of trees? Each time you sample, okay, you have a data set, you train, with this data set, you train your tree. Each time you subsample, I'll answer you later. Okay, so each time you subsample a small subset of your big training set, okay, with this data set, you build a tree, okay? You do that for many times. So you build like 20 or something trees, okay? You have multiple trees, and then we're doing your prediction. Either there are two ways. When you are doing regression, I mean this regression tree. Regression tree is because your outcome is continuous. So what you do is you predict with these 20 trees. Okay, you got 20 values. You take the average. This is one method. Or if you are doing classification, you predict with 20 trees and then you make a vote. With 20 trees you make a vote. Those class with the maximum vote will be the predicted result.
So you will choose one of the 20 trees to be your.
Yeah, one. Yeah, with majority vote. Okay, this is the random forest, this so-called random forest. So these two are closely related. Okay, to calculate, very simple. Later I'll show you how to calculate that. They're very simple, but the logic is this. I explain again. So now we have a tree model. We have a tree model, but it's just one tree. I mean, the structure is very simple. You just calculate your tree. I mean, you can also gauge the performance of the tree by setting your CP. You can set this smaller. I mean, they'll run more iterations. So, but one tree is perhaps not enough, okay? So you to enhance this, you can build more trees, okay? That one is called random forest. Random forest is something, I mean, in real life, in real data mining problems, is usually used. This method is actually usually used by the industry. How to do that? Actually, it's random forest, most simple one is you have a training set, and then you take subset from this training set, okay, with replacement, okay, you sample with replacement, and then use this small subset to train a tree, okay, to train a new tree. So you do that like 20 times, you do that many times, okay. You build many trees instead of just one tree. You build many trees, and then. You have a so-called ensemble model. It means an ensemble. It's a collection of trees. So you use this collection of trees to make prediction. Okay, if it is a regression problem, you use your test data. You calculate 20 numbers, 20 results. You take average. Okay, if it is a classification problem, you take a vote. You got 20 result, 20 resulting class, right? It can be class 1, class 2, class 3, right? The majority normally should be class 1, okay? And then you use class 1, you use that tree to predict the class, okay? Because at this time you are making a prediction. So the result is just the majority vote, so it's class 1. It doesn't matter which tree you are choosing. Okay, because you got 20 trees, I mean 10 of them vote for class 1, and then this particular test data will vote for class 1. Okay, so any other questions?
No, a bit more, like how the same tree making the threshold for each parameter to make the decision, like, so each model will be different, right?
Yeah.
And then in practice, we will want to know how much impact the PO4 will be. Then from the model, can we tell anything for a particular parameter, how much the impact is, and what will be the potential threshold we can choose?
You mean what?
in terms of only one parameter, a pure 4, right? So if let's say you have pure 4 value and then you want to say something about the final result, can you tell something from the decision tree?
I didn't answer your question.
Like you have pure 4 like value 50, right? So from here you will be classified under the right side, right? With the value 50, will you be able to know like it will more likely be in a yes or no, like blue?
You mean you want to have the probability of that 50
with
that? Okay, is that why you can calculate yourself? Okay, that one you really don't need a tree. You can estimate yourself directly with the data itself. You know why? Because, for example, your PO4 equals to bigger. Okay, your PO4 is you want to say you got a 50. You want to say how likely this PO4 bigger than 50 happened, right? Then very simple. You have a data set, right? You can directly calculate it. How to calculate that? You take a subset with PO4 bigger than 50 and divide it by the total number of data and get a probability.
Yes, but the threshold will be different. Here the cutoff will be 44, right?
Yeah.
Then one will be using the 50-something, yeah.
You mean you want to use the 50-something? This threshold is calculated by algorithm itself. It's not set. It's not set by myself, by me. It's set, you got an internal algorithm to do that.
Which means, like, roughly means, each
decision
tree will have a different cutoff point for each parameter.
Yeah. Yeah, they'll be different. They won't be always the same.
Okay, so it's a black box. We don't know what happened in the middle. We only know with the input.
Okay. There is only one probabilistic thing is by the choice of some trees. Some trees by the difference of exact algorithm, because there are many different algorithms to calculate this, by minimize different kind of errors. So there is one probabilistic thing is which parameter comes first, which comes first, which comes second. That can be random. That can be random for some algorithm. But the threshold is fixed. Threshold is calculated by the algorithm itself. That one is decided by algorithm. So it's not predefined by yourself. No, it's automatic. Okay. Any other questions? Someone asked me, how do you?
Will it be able to tell us like which parameter will be more important in terms of this like classification than the others?
Which parameter is more important? That one is got a particular thing. It's called a PCA, principal component analysis. Yeah, you do another thing. Okay, there is another tree. There is another tree algorithm. First step, you do PCA, so-called principal component analysis. So principal component analysis, then you can find the which variable is more important. Okay. Variable is more important means how much percentage of variance explained by this particular variable, okay? Explain the variation of the result. So you do PCA and then you select several variables and then you perform tree algorithm on that particular several variables. You can do that. That is a known tree algorithm. Yeah, that corresponds to what you ask. But PCA is another thing. Yeah.
Much more larger.
Yeah.
Machine learning already.
Yeah. Covering
this. Yeah.
If you want to know PCI, later I'll send you some links to do that. Yeah. But yeah. So here is a tree is automatic can be calculated.
Okay. Another one is comparing to the linear model or the static linear model, right?
Mm-hmm.
So in which condition will you like? Think the decision tree and the linear model will somehow be similar in terms of maybe the efficiency or in terms of the receiving.
Compare the advantage.
Yeah.
Okay, the advantage of tree model is this. The tree model is easy to understand. Okay, and then it's not a global model, just as what I said. Tree model is not a global model. It doesn't mean that you have to. It doesn't. Because you already, at the very beginning, you pile in two paths, right? or into more parts. It's not a global model. The second one is it incorporate with more data types, not just it can incorporate a categorical data inside. Okay, it can be yes, no, in categorical data. But for linear regression, if you want to do linear regression for categorical data, you have to plug in dummy variables, right? You have to plug in dummy variables to do that. For tree model, you don't need. You just plug in and then you can do that. Okay, and then it is robust with respect to holes. NAs, even if you put an NAs inside, it will also work. Yeah, not a big problem. So it's more robust. Yeah.
So it will just delete those data entries with NAs or?
No, you will put that into a category. Yeah. Any other questions? Yes? But okay, but yeah, in real life I don't use this. I use other things. Okay, we can do prediction. So let's do some prediction. Linear model prediction. So this is your prediction, okay? Linear model prediction dot A1. So just predict, okay? So this is your tree model prediction. Okay? So with this prediction, you can, as well, I told your friend, I mean your classmate, is you can calculate the errors. The model errors can be mean absolute error, okay. For example, for this one, yeah, mean absolute value is it's absolute value of the difference. I mean, prediction LM predict A1 minus A1, okay. And then you take the absolute value and then take the mean. So this is 12.9 something, okay. So let's see the tree model. So this is your regression tree. So it's smaller. You see? So visibly it's smaller. This one and this one. So linear, this previous one is your linear model, and then that one is your regression tree, your tree model. So this error is bigger. This is 12.9 something. This one error is 8.47 something. Yeah, I mean, error can be other types of error. You can say mean square error. You can mean, or instead of absolute value, you can take a square. Here you take a power 2 and then you can calculate mean square error. For example, it's mean square error is just a square 2. Yeah, you remove this. This is a mean square error. 161. And then mean square error for linear model is $295. Okay. So it's by comparing error, you can choose which model you want, which model is better. Okay. Sometimes this error measure is defined by the task. Sometimes the one who assigned a task to you will give you an error function. So you sub in the prediction and your prediction, and then the real data, they will use that particular function. But normally it will be some form of this. Mean square error, mean absolute value error, mean square percentage error, this kind of thing. Okay? Anyways, they'll give you the formula. So yeah, some other error form. I'll just copy paste on your file, so you can do that yourself. Okay, it's on the Google Drive. Okay. So by this, just now I said that talk about the random forest. Let's try the random forest as well. After all. So to do that, you have to install packages. random forest. So you install the random forest package. Okay. So after you install random forest package, you load it into the environment by library random forest. Okay. So to do prediction is also very simple. I mean, you just feed the random forest first. Okay. So how to do that? So random forest. This is your random forest. So you just feed the random forest model automatically by the R package. So and. And then you make a prediction. So this is the prediction, and then let's see the error performance of that. Random forest. So it's MAE1RF. Where is that number? Okay, I'll override it. Okay, just now we saw that. Okay, I overruled this value. So after all, let's calculate it. Okay, and then I do the linear model again. Okay, you see the comparison. So this is your original linear model, which is lousy. Okay, very bad. So So this is a mean squared error. This is calculated mean squared error of a prediction A1 and the linear modeling. So the error is 295. Okay, this one is a regression tree, the second one, the tree, so-called tree model. Tree model, the error is 161. Okay, so it's one tree. And now we change to the random forest. The random forest is the forest. I mean, the ensemble modeling. So it's 53. The error. So in for the prediction. Okay. So. Yeah, this is you got a better modeling. Otherwise, you can. Let me see. So this structure is more or less the same, because okay, you have you may later have other prediction models. For example, you have a neural network, okay. Neural network is follow the same structure. You train the neural network, you predict, and then you get the result. Okay, the algorithm are inside. I mean, mathematically very complicated. So if you are, you want to explore that, you can Google it, Wikipedia it, or if you don't know, you can email me. I can give you some material, read it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Theoretically, I can. There is a very good book by the community. It's called Element of Statistical Learning. Okay, so this is a book of reference used by the by largely academics. And then a more simpler book is called Pattern Recognition and Machine Learning. This is another book by Bishop. It's also very famous. Okay. It's also a very famous book by the machine learning community. Okay. So if you want to explore some theory, I mean mathematical formulas inside, is where you want to look at. Okay. You want to just use it. Okay. What I'm explaining is just linear model, random tree, random forest, just three model. But you, as what I said, the university professor is more advanced. But why they are more advanced? They know more models. Okay. So whenever you encounter a new model, you can go to R. R is very powerful inside a lot of models. You can look for help. So for example, you have forest, EST, and R. And then you have a package documentation. So you have a package documentation. You can read the exact. Examples. Okay. You can run the examples yourself and explore it a little bit more. Yeah. Okay. Otherwise, there is another thing, but it's more in Python. It's called sklearn. Okay, this one is in Python, not in R, but it got very good documentation. So, user guide. Okay, inside you got a whole lot of models. The supervised learning, what we are doing today is called supervised learning. Okay, what is supervised learning? Supervised learning means every time you have an input, the data set give you an output. So you are supervised, you are guided by the result. Okay? All these are supervised learning. So what we learned today is a linear model. But above that, you got generalized linear model, you got linear quadratic determinant analysis, rich regression, support vector machine, and then so nearest neighborhood, Gaussian process, and you got many, many models. Okay. Neural network have supervised version and unsupervised version. And then you also have unsupervised learning, okay? Clustering, yeah. Just now the k nearest neighborhood is closely related to k-mean method, okay? So you have a bunch of this method. I mean, you have a lot of other things to explore, and then the other things you go all relate to Python, how to manipulate that. But in terms of model, you have all this. I mean, if I'm read, you have the explanation is very good. For example, ordinary least squares. Okay, so this is ordinary least squares. This is the equation. This is error we are minimizing. This is what I said that by the error. So you have a line, you have dots. You're minimizing the errors. I mean, distance between the dots and the line. Okay, so this is the equation, and then you have a. By adding more terms, you have different models. Okay, and just give you a idea of what's happening. I mean, in the industry, so this is actually what happened in the industry. But of course, there are more advanced models like deep learning, use more sophisticated structured neural nets, or reinforced learning, means it train itself. I mean, train. It trains among itself, among different models. So Yeah, that's basically what I'm going to talk today. So if you have any questions, I do have any other questions. Understandable? Is it understandable? Yeah.
So in practice, how do we choose?
That's more of a case by case scenario. As what I said, if you have a very big data set, you can just simply remove those problematic points. Or that's all depend on you. I mean, yeah. If you don't want to remove them, you will try to fix the data, right? Fix the data, your tool treatment. If you got too many holes, you remove them definitely. This one you have to remove. If you don't have too many holes, you try to fill in those holes. The method of filling those holes got three of them. Either you use the simple guess, okay, or you use complicated guess. You got more complicated guess, right? By different functions. Yeah, they all depend on you.
What is the cutoff for you to remove the column if, let's say, it's not good, like more than 30% missing or more than?
That's depend on you. I mean, that's really depend on you. I mean, 20%, 30%, it's up to you. Yeah. Other things. What's the difference between LMRT and RF? LM means the linear model. RT means the regression tree. RF means the random forest. Okay. Yes. Sklearn. You Google SCIKIT. You Google SKLearn. So this is a Python package. Okay, this is a Python package. So to do that, you have to use Python, not R. But they got very good documentation on that. You can find a lot of models. It's like a dictionary. You can use it as a dictionary. I mean, you have a little explanation of the model if you don't understand, and then you can look at that. They got demos, they got examples. Yeah. But all the models here, okay, this is the subset of R. Okay, R is much, 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 much bigger than this. Okay, R can do what? I can show you some other things, what I'm doing. For example, recently, okay, I give you what I'm. Okay, this is my my research. So this is one way of representing data. Okay. So R can do those tree models, can do other things. For example, this one is a brain data. I can show you some. Wait, So you see, this is human brain. It is for treating medical data. Yeah, this is also done by R. Okay, R can do more complicated things instead of just the very simple thing. Okay, so for this one is evaluating the brain had got disease or not. Okay, Alzheimer or not. So it's just for. Yeah, this one is okay. Representing how to represent high-dimensional data. This is like a 30 dimensional data. I mean, you can represent it with curves, different characteristics. You can plot it like curves. So the red is one class, black is another class. So those also way of represent data. Okay. So this is more a simpler model. So R can do like quantitative finance. You can do those option calculation, and then you can also do technical analysis. You can do you can do marketing data analysis. You can do neural network. You can do linear regression. You can do many things. Okay, with a lot of packages. Okay, in R you got 2,000 or 3,000 packages. Yeah, or more than that. It is on the because university professor, after they publish the paper, they normally write an R package for that for the algorithm for that paper. So you want to evaluate the most advanced, the most cutting edge technology. Two ways, either MATLAB or R. Yeah. So you can use that, and then you can do that. Okay. Any other things? If not, we where is the class coordinator? So we can stop here.